Hello and welcome to this edition of Reporter's Diary. I'm Akshita Nandagopal. A recent study conducted shows that air pollution contributed to 6.7 million annual deaths globally in 2019, out of which India faced 1.67 million deaths. As northern India wakes up to another season of smoggy air and toxic PM2.5 levels in each breath, in the next half hour, we'll focus on air pollution that's poisoning us slowly and also earning it a bad repute of filthy air, something that Trump had referred to. Here's our special edition of Smoke in the Air.
India's capital has been waking up to this hazy view every day for over a week now. But the view isn't new. This was 2019 and 2018 and 2017. It is, after all, that time of the year. According to the Central Pollution Control Board, Delhi's overall air quality is in very poor category. And areas like Anand Vihar, Manduka, Wazirpur and Alipur have recorded worse. The air quality in these areas have periodically dipped to the severe category. And Delhiites are back grappling with the same issue. An issue that the governments, both at the centre and state, have struggled to address through long-term policy plans. But it isn't just the capital. The air is a toxic concoction across northern India. And government agencies say that the air quality will dip further in days to come. And like every year, with rising PM2.5 levels, comes the blame game rising from stubble burning. The Ministry of Earth Sciences Air Quality Monitor SUFFERS data suggests that more than 1,000 farm fires were spotted on 23rd October in neighbouring states. And the numbers just rose higher on 25th October. India Today found farm fires continue to singe fields in Punjab, despite the state government pledging to compensate farmers who are forced to burn their stubble.
ये तो सब इनकी बातें हैं, ये तो कहते हैं कि बराली को आग लगाना हटा दें, कैसे हटा दें, कोई पैसा तो कोई देता नहीं है, अभी कोई हमारे पास हल ही नहीं आग लगाने के अलावा.
With government compensation still on drawing boards, Punjab farmers have gone ahead and taken the easy route. Some are even offering money to the government to lighten their burden.
ये सरकार चाहती है, उन्हें 5000 रुपया किलो प्रति देने तैयार हैं. वो साड़ी कांड के बीज दो बेकनी पराली जो बीज दो बे 5000 रुपया किलो साड़ी काट लो बे स्टैटी राही काट लो बे बैंक राही काट लो बे नहीं जानू 50% सब्सिडी दो बे.
Estimates say that there has been a 280% rise in stubble burning. The situation is particularly grim in Punjab, which produces half of 40 million ton generated every year.
We've seen how farmers who feed this land are blamed every year for almost half a decade now for the pollution that chokes us. They have a different story of despair and economic hardship to defend their action of stubble burning. Here's a ground report by Aishwarya Paliwal and video journalist Amit Kumar.
Here's the tale of two farmers from Punjab. One who hasn't burnt stubble for the past 4 years, and the other who burns it year after year.
ਆਦੇ ਆਉਣ ਵਾਲੀ ਨਸਲ ਨੂੰ ਕੀ ਜਵਾਬ ਦੇਵਾਂਗੇ? ਇਸ ਕਰਕੇ ਕੋਸ਼ਿਸ਼ ਕੀਤੀ ਆ ਵੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਆਪਣੇ ਘਰ ਤੋਂ ਸ਼ੁਰੂ ਕਰੀਏ.
ਸਾਨੂੰ ਵੀ ਪਤਾ ਵੀ ਇਹਦੇ ਨਾਲ ਮਨੁੱਖਤਾ ਤੇ ਅਸਰ ਪੈਂਦਾ, ਨਹੀਂ ਪੈਣਾ ਚਾਹੀਦਾ, ਪਰ ਸਾਡੀ ਮਜਬੂਰੀ ਹੈ. ਜੋ ਵੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਖਰਚਾ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਆਪਦਾ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ, ਸਾਨੂੰ ਕੋਈ ਕੁਛ ਨਹੀਂ ਦੇ ਰਿਹਾ.
50-year-old Gurpreet Singh in Faridkot district of Punjab has turned an advocate against burning of paddy straw. He has a philosophical take on the issue.
Pavan Guru, Pani Sada Pita, Jedi Tarti Sadi Ma, Asi Apani Jedi Ma, Edi Hekate Agade Balange, the Sanu Dokunda Sadi Ma, DJ Hekanu Asi Aglamage, Skarke Sichone, Tarti Havati Pani Sambalakarge, Jedi Sade Kudrati Somia Kudrata and Sanu Data de Tingahunga. ਇਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਸਾਂਭ ਸੰਭਾਲ ਕਰਨਾ ਸਾਡਾ ਮੁੱਢਲਾ ਫਰਜ਼ ਆ। ਮਤਲਬ ਅੱਗ ਲਾਉਣੀ ਛੱਡਤੀ ਤੇ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਸਕੂਨ ਆ, ਮੇਰਾ ਖਰਚਾ ਜ਼ਰੂਰ ਵੱਧ ਹੁੰਦਾ ਪਰ ਮਨ ਨੂੰ ਸੰਤੁਸ਼ਟੀ ਆ ਵੀ ਮੈਂ ਆਪਦੀ ਧਰਤੀ ਮਾਂ ਦੀ ਹਿੱਕ ਦੇ ਉੱਤੇ ਅੱਗ ਨਹੀਂ ਬਾਲ ਰਿਹਾ।
5 ਇਅਰਸ ਬੈਕ ਗੁਰਪ੍ਰੀਤ ਟੂ ਯੂਜ਼ ਟੂ ਬਰਨ ਸਟਬਲ, ਦੈਨ ਹੀ ਸਟਾਪਡ। ਹੀ ਹੈਜ਼ 8 ਏਕਰਸ ਆਫ ਲੈਂਡ ਐਂਡ ਹੀ ਮੇਕਸ ਦੀ ਇਨਵੈਸਟਮੈਂਟ ਆਫ ਟਰਨਿੰਗ ਸਟਬਲ ਇਨਟੂ ਬੰਡਲਸ ਫਾਈਨੈਂਸ਼ੀਅਲੀ ਵਾਇਬਲ ਫਾਰ ਹਿਮ। To put stubble to use, Gurpreet Singh calls a baler on his fields and pays 1500 rupees per acre. The baler converts stubble on his land into bundles which are then exported to a biomass power plant. This converts stubble into electricity. But Gurpreet concedes while he can afford to not burn stubble, a majority of farmers in his district can't.
ਅੱਗ ਨਹੀਂ ਲਾਉਂਦਾ, ਮੇਰਾ ਵਿਸ਼ਾ ਹੋਰ ਆ ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਮੈਂ ਵਾਤਾਵਰਨ ਨੂੰ ਪ੍ਰੇਮ ਕਰਦਾ। ਹਰ ਇੱਕ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਦੀ ਇਹ ਪਹੁੰਚ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗੀ ਵੀ ਉਹ ਆਰਥਿਕ ਤੌਰ 'ਤੇ ਵੱਧ ਨੁਕਸਾਨ ਚੱਲ ਰਹੇ। ਮੈਨੂੰ ਤਾਂ ਇਹ ਵੀ ਚਲੋ ਨੁਕਸਾਨ ਹੋਜੂਗਾ ਕੋਈ ਗੱਲ ਨਹੀਂ, ਖਰਚਾ ਵੱਧ ਪਏਗਾ ਕੋਈ ਗੱਲ ਨਹੀਂ, ਮਨ ਨੂੰ ਸੰਤੁਸ਼ਟੀ ਆ, ਪਰ ਹਰ ਕਿਸਾਨ ਦੀ ਉਹ ਮੇਰੇ ਵਾਲੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ ਮਤਲਬ ਸਥਿਤੀ ਉਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈਗੀ। 4 ਸਾਲ ਹੋ ਗਏ ਝੋਨੇ ਦੀ ਪਰਾਲੀ ਨੂੰ ਅੱਗ ਨਹੀਂ ਲਾ ਰਿਹਾ।
Right next to Gurpreet's field where the baler is working is 45-year-old Veerpal Singh who has 2 acres of land and is busy burning stubble. A farmer since his teens, he earns 60,000 to 80,000 rupees annually from rice and wheat cultivation.
Subsidy mile sanu mile 4 kille zameen a thonu dassya va 4 kille 14 mar le a ek aunde sanu bhai nu kise nu vi kuch nahi ajje tak mila ga kise niyo koi nahi sahayta। ਇਹ ਵੀ ਅਸੀਂ ਤਾਂ ਆਪਦੇ ਕਾਰਨ ਕਰਕੇ ਜਿਵੇਂ ਹਾਈ ਕੋਰਟਾਂ ਦਾ ਇੰਨੇ ਉੱਥੇ 15,000 ਰੁਪਇਆ ਦੇਵਾਂਗੇ, ਇੰਨੇ ਕਿਸਾਨਾਂ ਨੂੰ ਐਂ ਦੇਵਾਂਗੇ, ਕੁਛ ਨਹੀਂ ਮਿਲਦਾ ਕਿਤੇ।
ਵਿਦਆਊਟ ਐਨੀ ਗਵਰਨਮੈਂਟ ਏਡ ਵੀਰਪਾਲ ਸਿੰਘ ਵਿਲ ਹੈਵ ਟੂ ਸਪੈਂਡ 6,000 to 8,000 ਰੁਪੀਸ ਪਰ ਏਕਰ ਟੂ ਕਲੀਅਰ ਦ ਸਟਬਲ ਫਰੋਮ ਹਿਸ ਫੀਲਡ ਫਾਰ ਈਚ ਕ੍ਰੋਪ ਹਾਰਵੈਸਟ। ਸਿੰਪਲ ਮੈਥਮੈਟਿਕਸ ਡਿਡਿਊਸਿਸ ਅ ਕਲੀਅਰ ਸਬਸਟ੍ਰੈਕਸ਼ਨ ਆਫ 12,000 to 16,000 ਰੁਪੀਸ from his annual income of 60,000 to 80,000 rupees. That's where he turns to burning the stubble.
There are many farmers in the state of Punjab who do not want to burn the stubble. One of the first machines they bring on their land is called a baler. Now the job of the baler is to convert the stubble into these bundles which are then transported to various companies. Most of the farmers spend roughly 1500 rupees per acre to bring the baler on their field. Now that's an amount which a smaller farmer does not want to spend, which is why he opts for the easier option, which is to just burn down the paddy straw. Most of the farmers are of the opinion that despite government promises, they haven't got a single rupee till date. The government had promised them a compensation of 2,500 rupees to those farmers who do not indulge in burning of paddy straw. But despite those promises, farmers on the ground say they haven't got a single rupee, which is why now they are choosing the easier option, which is to just burn down the entire paddy straw.
Though a majority of farmers turn to burning crop stubble, there are a few who are trying to make a difference. The Gujar community in the state is involved in picking up and converting stubble into bundles. 35-year-old Ravi from Taran Taran belongs to the Gujar community. He helps farmers in cutting the stubble and then making bundles of it and stores it in heaps outside his house. He feeds his cattle with this stubble for 6 months until the next harvesting season. Living 28 kilometers from Amritsar, Ravi and his family has been making stubble bundles for the past 2 generations.
जो इसके खेत होता है वो लोग आग नहीं लगाते, क्यों नहीं लगाते? क्यों हम लेकर आते हैं ना उसको, आधा पैसा वो डालते हैं आधा हम डालते हैं, तो अपना हम लोग गठा बना लेते हैं।
कितने सालों से कर रहे हैं ऐसा?
ऐसा हमारे जो पुराने वर्ष थे वो सब लोग यही काम करते थे।
अच्छा, तो सालों साल से चलता आ रहा है
ये? हमारा तो जात जो है गुजर गई, हम लोग यही काम करते हैं 12 महीने। ये पशु को डालते हैं, ठीक है, 6 महीने के लिए हमने इकट्ठा किया हुआ है, 6 महीने के बाद में फिर हम लोग निकल जाते हैं चारा के लिए, ठीक है, उसके बाद में आगे फिर यही हमारा मतलब 6 महीने तक हम लोग ये खवाते हैं।
But then Ravi is an aberration to the norm, as most people in his community and a majority of the farmers took to crop burning as it was an easier option available. The government acknowledges the contribution of people like Ravi from the Gujar community.
Punjab, Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh produce 40 ton of parali every year. From this, a major part comes from the state of Punjab at 20 million tons. I'm standing on heaps of parali which have been converted into these bundles. These will later be used to feed the cattle. But farmers say not all of them have the kind of manpower which is required to convert parali into these kind of bundles. Also, not everyone wants to feed the cattle with this, which is why they are left with no resort but to turn to the easier option, which is crop burning.
In the middle of this pollution crisis, politics continues to play on in full swing, where political parties try to score extra brownie points using pollution as a political tool.
It's apocalypse all over again. These images speak for themselves. The quality of air that Delhi is breathing has nosedived to severe mark. In some areas in the capital, the air quality index was over the 300 mark. As farm fires rage on across the neighboring states of Punjab and Haryana, Delhi government has swung into action. Capital's Environment Control Body has announced imposition of a graded response plan to tackle air pollution. It includes banning diesel generators, checking construction sites for dust and pollution, use of smog guns to control dust, and banning burning of biomass. Chief Minister Kejriwal has also launched Red Light On, Gaadi Off campaign to tackle air pollution. As the capital air quality plummets, Delhi government versus centre politics is peaking. Union Environment Minister claimed that stubble burning contributes only 4% to air pollution.
पंजाब सरकार को मैं फिर से एक बार अपील करता हूं कि वो तुरंत हरकत में आए और पराली कम जले, इसके लिए उनके भी बच्चों का मुद्दा है। अभी तो केवल 4% लोड पराली का है, तो 96% प्रदूषण लोकल फैक्टर्स से है।
दिल्ली चीफ मिनिस्टर अरविंद केजरीवाल वाज क्विक टू काउंटर द एनवायरनमेंट मिनिस्टर।
जो पराली जलने की वजह से धुआं दिल्ली आ रहा है, उसके बारे में तो हम कुछ नहीं कर सकते, लेकिन दिल्ली में अपने पोल्यूशन को इस वक्त कम करने के लिए जो जो कदम हम उठा सकते हैं वो सभी कदम उठाने चाहिए। पिछले कुछ दिनों में हम लोगों ने कई सारे स्टेप्स लिए हैं पोल्यूशन कम करने के लिए। एंटी डस्ट कैंपेन चालू किया है। दिल्ली में जो पराली उगती है उसको जलाने की ज़रूरत ना पड़े, उसके लिए हमने बायो डिकम्पोज़र पूसा इंस्टीट्यूट द्वारा जो बनाया गया उसका इस्तेमाल शुरू किया है। इलेक्ट्रिक व्हीकल पॉलिसी अनाउंस की है, ट्री ट्रांसप्लांटेशन पॉलिसी अनाउंस की है, कई सारे कदम हमने उठाए हैं।
Minister Javadekar later clarified, saying that 4% share of stubble burning in AQI in Delhi pertained only to this week. He added that several local factors like vehicular pollution, non-agricultural biomass burning, dust are primarily responsible for high air pollution during winters in Delhi. The Environment Ministry itself says that the share of stubble burning in air pollution in Delhi between 8th October and 9th December last year was greater than 15% on 6 days, and on a single day it was more than 40%. In fact, a 2019 report by government agency System of Air Quality and Weather Forecasting said that the share of stubble burning in Delhi's pollution rose to 46% on 1st November last year.
While a war of words has also erupted between the Union Minister Prakash Javadekar as well as the CM, stating that the problem of pollution in Delhi is being caused due to stubble burning. That's what the Chief Minister believes, but Union Environment Minister has said that the stubble burning is only leading to about 4% of the pollution's contribution in the national capital. With Sanjay Kumar, Milan Sharma for India Today.
We're slipping into a short break here on India Today. On the other side of the break, we'll try to explore the possibilities with regards to how we can get out of this pollution crisis in North India and particularly in the national capital. Stay with us. Rajdeep Sardesai spoke to Siddharth Singh, author of The Great Smog of India and also energy and climate policy researcher, as well as Karthik Ganeshan, who is a fellow in CEEW, in our primetime show. News Unlocked, to understand what really is the road ahead and where is it that the legislative as well as the judiciary system is failing citizens to help them in breathing clean air. Here's an excerpt of the discussion.
Let's first therefore examine the immediate solutions that the government is proposing to try and improve the quality of air that we breathe in North India. Karthik Ganeshan is joining us. He is fellow at CEEW. He joins us. I'm also joined by Siddharth Singh. He's the author of a book, The Great Smog of India. He's an energy and climate policy researcher. I appreciate both of you joining us. Let's turn to what the government is proposing and what they told the Supreme Court yesterday, Karthik, because the government says we are coming out with a comprehensive legislation on air quality management in the National Capital Region and adjoining areas. Do you believe that a tough, strict law is what we need to improve the quality of air?
Rajiv, absolutely. There is definitely a need for a law that states clearly what the intention is. And I think there have been many efforts made in the past, but what has not happened is the government has not lived through on the resources that are needed to implement any such law. And in this particular case, right, I mean, we've been saying it out aloud and a lot of civil society groups have been talking about it. I think blaming the farmers is perhaps the wrong thing to do. And if you look at the core of it, the engagement of the farmers starts with what's called the agricultural extension system. And any change that you need to bring up really means that the agricultural extension system needs to be strengthened. And what has really happened is ever since, you know, we got all the technology through to them for increasing productivity, what we've not done is, as we've asked them to sort of change and adapt to the times, that extension system has become weak. And enabling them to sort of think beyond rice wheat cropping, think about other ways of cropping itself, right? Whether it is, you know, using of this happy cedar or any other mechanism, is completely missing. And you need to put money into those systems.
No, but why? My limited point, Karthik, is why blame the farmer? Let's be very clear. Vehicular pollution is perhaps far more damaging to the quality of air that we breathe today than the farmer of Punjab or Haryana. Every year, we blame the farmer as if stubble burning is the sole reason. Let's be clear. Also on laws, let's be very clear. There's already an Air Prevention and Control Pollution Act 1981. There's an Environment Protection Act 1986. You don't enforce existing laws. The government says we'll come up with a new legislation. A, why blame the farmers? And B, is a law the solution?
Absolutely. So all of these laws, so the pollution control boards and all of them have really been set up to monitor what was, you know, legacy polluters, right? Legacy polluters are industries. So the role of all of these pollution control bodies was to really monitor what were industries doing. But in today's times, the sources of pollution are multifarious. You've got vehicular pollution in cities, you've got construction and demolition dust, you've got resuspended dust from, you know, transport moving around, you've got stuff that gets blown in. Right, there's household air pollution arising from solid fuel use all around, you know, the areas around the NCR, the rural areas. So the problem is the pollution control board, that legacy entity, has very little say in the way each one of these sources behaves. They at best have the ability to monitor industrial stacks, mm-hmm. right, which is your power plants and perhaps some of your, you know, industries that are dotting the landscape here, which are also significant, but they have no control over any of the other items. And more importantly, they don't have the resources to even address what was in their remit.
You know, so, Siddharth Singh, let's be clear. You know, the worry is that this is an annual problem. And the worry is that the government now, when faced by a court order, comes and says, look, we'll bring in a new law. We'll bring a comprehensive legislation. I know that there are countries like the U.S. Clean Air Act, which empowers the federal agencies to take action against those who are violators. Do you believe that can happen in India? Can you really act against violators?
Rajdeep, I would say, unfortunately, we do not have the capacity and the skills needed at the ground level to actually take action on the problem. So I think you're right that on paper, we may have the necessary laws, we may have the necessary regulations, such as the Air Act and so on. However, when it comes to actual implementation, our state pollution control boards are absolutely in shambles. I've been speaking with a few state pollution control board officials, and the state of play for them, you know, is actually very worrisome. For example, we have situations where engineers who have no background in law are expected to write the first legal frame, you know, paperwork to take action against any polluters. Naturally, these laws and these cases end up being lost, or they end up being rejected at the first count, because obviously an engineer will not be able to do something like that. Secondly, they are overburdened and completely spread thin. They're not allowed any specialization. So one day they may be expected to be, you know, working on something like auditing an industry. The other day they'd be running around doing bureaucratic duties. And in the case of the Haryana Pollution Control Board, they even have, you know, responsibilities that have nothing to do with air pollution. For example, poultry farms are under their ambit. Now they're already stretched thin. What are they doing with, you know, worrying about chicken production? So these are the kind of problems that we have at the ground level. So until we address that, until we provide them the necessary resources, we don't even have budgetary allocations for these pollution control boards. They earn their revenues out of selling certificates to industry. So until we really solve that problem, these laws by themselves will not be enough.
So are you saying, therefore, what you are saying is it's you need legislation, but you also need an enabling environment which allows the state pollution boards to actually effectively act on the legislative powers that they are provided. Am I correct that you actually need to start giving primacy and specialization to state pollution boards to act against violators?
Absolutely correct. We need, you know, the necessary training. We need to ensure that each pollution control board official is able to be at the same posting for some time, that they're able to work with the stakeholders. It's not a you versus them mentality that we have. I think, you know, one of the things that, you know, you had kind of mentioned earlier, that is this a question of blaming the farmers? I don't think it's a question of blaming anyone. Most polluters in the country, be it in the form of truck drivers, be it anyone who's using biomass to burn to get heat in the peak of the winters, they're not polluting because they're malicious in nature. They're polluting because we have no alternatives. Unless we're able to work with these stakeholders to provide alternatives, to provide pathways to transition to better, cleaner fuels, we will not be able to really address the problem.
Karthik, you know, the fact is, though, that the Supreme Court in the past has at times been successful. To some extent, some of the green tribunals have been successful. It was the Supreme Court, for example, that ensured that a greener fuel, CNG, was implemented in Delhi NCR region almost now 20 years ago. So do you believe that proactive legislation or proactive a proactive Supreme Court and a green tribunal system is actually going to raise consciousness? Do you see that happening at all? Do you see any change at all?
So I think the saving grace over the last few years, right, has definitely been this proactive judiciary that's really pulled up the executive and everybody at you know, who's in charge of implementing all these policies. But what has really happened is that with this executive being devoid of the resources needed, it's become a bit of a joke, in the sense that, you know, every now and then the chief secretaries of all the states get pulled up for, you know, not implementing, for example, the directive of the NGT or the Supreme Court. But at the end of the day, everybody knows that the money to pay the farmers, whether it's the 100 rupees per quintal or 2,000 rupees per acre, none of it is there with the states. So aren't each of these people actually in contempt of a court order? What is being done? Obviously, you can't put them behind bars for it, because the court knows that the wherewithal doesn't exist within the financial you know, system that they operate in, right, to actually follow through on what the court says. At the same time, the court has also been sort of found wanting in its technical understanding of the issue. For instance, you know, the smog towers that the court has basically been prescribing, right? It is such a ludicrous solution to the problem. But the fact is that the government of Delhi, under pressure from the Supreme Court, has had to commit 20 crores of precious resources to get this thing built in the next 10 months, where no university across the country is actually willing to touch it with a barge pole, saying that I don't know the understand the science behind it. It's vague at best. Mm-hmm. But yet, you know, the activism on the Supreme Court, unfortunately, also pushes unscientific solutions for the problem. Right? I don't want to digress into that area, but unfortunately, I think beyond a point, the activism on part of the court doesn't really help. I think the executive and the legislature need to take the advice of scientists who understand the issue very well and put the money where the mouth is and ensure that those sources of pollutions are addressed and in the manner that Siddharth has already spoken about.
And that's all time we have in this edition of Reporters Diary. Thank you very much for watching here on India Today. We'll continue getting you all the latest news and updates on the pollution crisis.
Hi everyone, Preeti Chaudhary here. Hope you like this video. For latest news and analysis, like and subscribe to the India Today YouTube channel. And don't forget to press the bell icon to stay updated. Thank you for watching.